Hello and welcome to the 2016-2017 Leadership Franklin Graduation Day and Group Project Presentations. I'd like to welcome all of our Leadership Franklin alumni, members of the media, and special guests this morning. My name is Jeff Smith, and I will be introducing the presentations today. At the beginning of each Leadership Franklin year, the class is divided into groups. Each group is asked to come up with a project that is aimed at serving the Franklin community. We're excited to hear about these presentations today and learn more of their benefit to our community. Our first group is group number one, and I had breakfast with this group this morning, and I learned that there is a reason that they are called group number one, because they are the number one group of the class. So, the members are Denise Andre, Travis Dumke, Tim Stillings, Adam Hicks, and Amy Diaz Barriga, group number one.
Thank you, Jeff. Team one is comprised of five very imaginative, creative, and ambitious members of Leadership Franklin. That's not me. There we go. And Jeff just introduced who we are, so I won't go through that again, but you've gotten to know us individually over this past year, and you can imagine how difficult it was for us to reach a consensus on the project that we were going to do, because we think big, and we wanted to do something really awesome for our community. So let me guide you through our journey as we vetted our potential projects. As a baseline, we agreed that our project must contribute to the livability and walkability goals within the city of Franklin. And of course, it must be consistent with our historic and preservation values. And to the greatest extent possible, we wanted it to be unique. So, we considered and debated many potential ideas. Originally, we discussed taking an existing city park and incorporating some type of small, intimate water feature to increase the utility and the attractiveness of the park. But we were disappointed to see that a team from Leadership Niagara many years ago had already done this, so it wouldn't have actually been unique. But we thought, well, what if we take this same concept and maybe add some mood lighting and maybe decorate it up for special events? But this introduction of electricity back in 1896, and that was a project done by Leadership Niagara of 1896-97, the best class, they killed that idea for us. So we went back to the drawing board. We thought... We caucused, we thought, and we caucused some more, and eventually we just really got frustrated. But then we realized, hey, everybody likes a statue. So we had some early discussions with City Hall and received tentative approval to place a statue of historical value in a very prominent place in Franklin. We contracted with a famed local artist, Mr. Mike Angelo, you may have heard of him. He produced a sculpture for us, but this one got shot down too. Our tentative approval was pulled, and we really can't figure out why, but back to the drawing board again. We even came up with an updated version of that, but it was not consistent with our historical values, so we had to go back to the drawing board again. So we thought, well, maybe there's something we can do with the town square, spruce it up, put five creative minds to do something awesome for the town square. But Leadership Vatican, back in 1506 and 1507, beat us to that one. Even down to the smallest detail of where we have the view from St. Ken's Basilica. Well, then, Leadership Athens beat us to our next project, but they didn't get it finished before graduation day. So we thought, hey, we could finish this monument before graduation day. But Leadership Franklin in 1897-98 beat us to that one too. So back to the drawing board, and we thought, well, why don't we just go plant a tree somewhere and meet at Gray's upstairs once a month and pat each other on the back and tell each other what a great job we did for the city of Franklin. But Team One's much better than that. This idea of planting a single tree really morphed into something really, really big, a park-it park concept.
Parks are urban open spaces at a very small scale. These pocket parks can be tucked into and scattered throughout a neighborhood where they can serve the residents that live and work nearby. These small parks tend to act like scaled down neighborhood parks, but still try to meet a variety of needs. Spaces for relaxing and meeting with friends, taking a lunch break, or exercising your dog or children. One of the unique and exciting characteristics of a pocket park is that it can be created out of vacant lots or otherwise forgotten spaces within the neighborhood. Many pocket parks are the results of community groups, private entities, or foundations reclaiming these spaces for the benefit of a local neighborhood. Ideally, these parks are closely tied to the neighborhoods they serve. Because they are created opportunistically, they tend to be scattered and disconnected, but with planning, they can be connected with greenways or bike paths or sidewalks.
So our team met together, and as we discussed this idea that we had of bringing a park, a pocket park, to a community, we found no better place to start than with the city of Franklin. You may not know, but the city of Franklin has in its possession several parcels of property that have either been condemned or abandoned throughout our community. We identified a couple of properties, and we quickly focused in on a property off of Old Liberty Pike. Old Liberty Pike parallels Liberty. It's directly to the south of the factory. It used to continue on and go underneath the railroad tracks before it became too hazardous for our modern-day vehicular traffic. So the road stopped at Daniels Drive as it was connected to Liberty and has created in itself a micro-community very much in need of additional green space. So we looked at this piece of property. It's approximately a half an acre. It's the next to last parcel on Old Liberty Pike before you get to Daniels, and it backs up to Liberty Creek. The property previously had a home on it that was condemned in the 2010 floods, and the city took possession of the property through the FEMA aid, removed the house, and now provides maintenance and upkeep of this property.
Okay, so our first step in repurposing the lot was to consult the area neighbors to determine if a pocket park was a desirable addition to their neighborhood, and if so, what would they want it to look like? With the help of the city planning department, we advertised and held a public meeting on the lot in late winter. 15 households, about 20 people attended the meeting. It was a nice day in November, thankfully. There was surprisingly a lot of foot traffic from people walking to the farmer's market down Old Liberty over to the factory. So they were coming from Franklin Road, walking down Old Liberty Pike, going to the factory. So it's great. We got a lot of foot traffic. Alderman Margaret Martin and Ann Peterson were kind enough to attend and speak to the area residents about the benefits of our idea. We shared with them some concept designs from other pocket parks across the country. We put them on boards. You can see them on the screen there. But it was more important for us to engage their ideas and hear what they wanted. So we captured all their thoughts on a flip chart so that we can incorporate their ideas into the final design. You can see some of their ideas here on the screen. We were very concerned because one neighbor who lived very close to the lot was adamant that he did not want anything to change. But by the end of the meeting and by the time he heard our ideas, he latched on to a few and eventually agreed that as long as there was no playground equipment, all would be okay. Yeah, so that was great. We kind of turned him around, which was nice. Then we partnered with the City of Franklin to complete a conceptual design. Collaboration with municipal departments is crucial to most City Leadership Franklin project, so we wanted to especially thank the following: Lisa Clayton, Brian Walker, and Todd Schnackenberg from the City of Franklin Parks Department, and Paul Holzen and Jeff Willoughby from the City of Franklin Engineering Department.
So after we went to the drawing board with the city, what's next? We had to partner with the city arborist as well as the stormwater department because one of the big initiatives is rebuilding the stream buffer zone. So at that point, they gave us a specific list of bushes, shrubs, and grasses that had to be planted in the stream buffer area, which covers 40 feet from any creek bed or stream. So we worked with them to go in, and we had a late winter work day with our group to where we all went out there and planted approximately 25 to 30 shrubs, bushes, different types of natural grasses, things like that, to build up that 40 feet behind the property that backs up to the creek in case of another flood. So not only do we have our group members, we were fortunate enough to have a lot of little helpers thanks to Adam Hicks and his family. His kids got out there and spent a couple hours digging with us and planting some shrubs with us, so that was great. So after the stream buffer was built up, we then had to partner with two local contractors and landscaping companies to do what we could not do, and that's install our walkway and sitting area for the park. We used pervious pavers that the city requires to, because it's in a flood zone, we couldn't do anything that could be devastated by another flood and cause an issue there. So the two local contractors that we used were Blake Shelton Landscaping, who's a Franklin local, graduated from Centennial High School, as well as G&G Contracting, which is Adam Goolsby, who also is a Franklin local that graduated from Page High School. So thank you for their help. Couldn't have done it without them. The new construction in the area, for anybody that's familiar with the street itself, it's a huge redevelopment right now in Franklin. There's new construction on both sides of the street, up and down all the way. So there was a recent study that was done by the city of Greenville in South Carolina that says small and medium parks that are well maintained help increase property value of that specific area. So we thought our park would fit in perfectly with the redevelopment that's already happening in that area and hopefully help to stabilize and increase the value of the properties there. So fast forward to present day, our path is complete. We're still waiting on a little bit of landscaping to be done, but our walkway and our sitting area will be fully completed this week. Our benches are being installed Friday. The city of Franklin, once they install the benches and the final landscaping is done, we're going to be having a ribbon cutting. Hope to have some local media there for some coverage and really unveil our pocket park to the residents of this street and the surrounding areas for them to enjoy.
All right. During the course of this project, it occurred to us that we were doing something more than just making a place look better in an established neighborhood in Franklin for the neighbors to enjoy. We were helping to restore an area, specifically a lot, where someone once called home. A place where someone, maybe a family, had daily sought shelter from the elements and also from the stress of the world. A place where they had dreams, where they made memories, a place where they were building their life, a place that they called home. At the lot, there were remnants of a driveway where someone probably pulled in at night after a long day. There was a clothesline post that remained in the back of the lot where someone, probably during the life of this home, hung their laundry out to dry. You know, in Franklin, we're all about preservation, and rightfully so. It's what makes our community unique. It's what we do appreciate. But the home that stood on this lot couldn't be preserved. The person or the family that lived in this home would never be able to rebuild there. Their home was torn down. They had to start over. They had to deal with the devastation and all the emotions that went along with the flood of 2010. Not only was this home devastated by the flood, but the neighbors had lost a place, a part of their neighborhood. And for the neighbors who passed by this vacant lot each day, it was a constant reminder of what had plagued their neighborhood. And now what remained was just an empty lot. So breathing some life into this lot produced some positive energy for those that remained. In the future, it will give everyone in the area a place to enjoy, a place to reflect, a place to appreciate. A quiet, peaceful place that they can enjoy for years. And all because Leadership Franklin gives us the opportunities to be inspired, to be engaged, to see our community through a different kind of lens that is unique to itself, and to serve our community in a way that not only changes our surroundings, but also changes us personally and professionally forever. Thank you for letting us be a part of creating a beautiful pocket park for the residents of Franklin. Please use it and enjoy it.
Good job, team. Excellent.
So while group number two is making their way up, I would like to apologize to group number one. Part of my role as MC is I'm supposed to give a brief summary of the group's project, and I neglected to do that. So with that, though, I'm going to award you guys 100 points towards your final score of the presentation today. So, all right. Thank you. Everybody?
No.
Oh, one more? Okay. All right, so group number two, the members are Tony Cassio, Julie Miller, Matt McGallanese, Brian Dolschel, and Cassie Jones. Group two's project is called Get Rad, which is Get Real Against Drugs. It's not Get Rad, group two?
I think she's got us out of order. We're actually.
Ah, okay. Wrong on my sheet, but that's okay. We'll get it. Okay, the group three is a video presentation of visionaries in our community. This team project seeks to preserve our history relative to the business impact of leaders in our community. Let's hear from group number two. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Cassie Jones. As Jeff said, the name of our project is Living Legacies in Williamson County. And the purpose of this project was really just to interview five leaders in our community that have really impacted the quality of life here in Franklin. we wanted to honor five unsung heroes in our community that have really done the work over the years, rolled up their sleeves, and gotten in the trenches and made our quality of life better. We thought it would be a travesty not to capture the voices of these unsung heroes while we still had the opportunity. The five individuals that we chose to honor in this project are Bill Harlan, Jane Franks, Calvin Lahue, Mary Mills, and Jimmy Gentry. Charles Pulliam, we want to thank. He produced the video for us, and he spent countless hours editing on a very limited budget and a very narrow time frame, and we want to thank him for his dedication to this project. We captured hours of footage on each of these individuals, but in the essence of time, what we plan to show you today is an introduction to the video that encapsulates each of these five leaders. The full-length videos of each of these leaders will be housed on the Leadership Franklin YouTube channel, and you can go there to view them in their entirety. Before we start the video, each of the members of our group just wanted to take 1 minute to really explain why we chose each of these individuals. Bill Harlan and his family have had a significant impact on Franklin. There's a rich history of horses here in this community, and they have had a great impact on our economy over the years. Bill and his family made the decision in 2004 to sell Harlansdale Farm to the city of Franklin, and it is now named the Park at Harlansdale. And I just wanted to say, I had an opportunity a few weeks ago to participate in a spring break camp that benefited the Boys and Girls Club of Franklin. And it was a really neat thing to see underserved kids in the community get to fish, groom a horse, and hike in the trails at the park at Harlansdale Farm, an opportunity that they would otherwise not have had. And this is exactly what Bill Harlan and his family wanted for the park at Harlansdale.
Okay, we also chose to highlight Magistrate Jane C. Franks for many reasons. We were drawn to Jane for her many years of dedication to Franklin in Williamson County. And after serving 20 years as General Sessions and juvenile judge, she retired and stayed retired for 15 years. And after 15 years of retirement, and her love of children drew her back in. So at this time, she's out of retirement, and she's currently the part-time magistrate for the juvenile court. And let me also mention that she was very instrumental early on with the founding of CASA, as well as the Alternative Learning Center. And somehow she still stays very active in her church, and she keeps track of, she had 12 children during all this, so let's not forget that. But now I think the count is up to 33 grandchildren and 28 great-grandchildren. So that's dedication. Magistrate Jane C. Franks.
I would like to comment on somebody I think most of us know, Calvin Lahue. Calvin, if you've met him, is just a wonderful, magnetic person. And I did not know so many of the things that he had done until we did these interviews. He was chosen because he's really a shining example of leadership, and particularly from the standpoint of having vision. And his visions about what could be for the future were often put into action. And the results were important to the community and have become part of the fabric of Franklin. So his impact from his ideas has been very strong. And he had guts. And I think sometimes leadership and the people that make a difference in the community have to get on point. They have to risk their own money, their own reputations, and bring a lot of people to bear on future projects. And it just takes a lot of guts sometimes. In his own words, and you can see it in the video, he says, "Let's not let Franklin, Williamson County, become any town USA."
We also chose Miss Mary Mills. She grew up in Franklin, and after she graduated, became an educator for over 40 years. And had an unwavering focus on children that is still here today. Her commitment to community through serving on numerous boards and focus on the community and how to keep Franklin and the children of Franklin continue to stay the way it has been, but also grow. She loves the city of Franklin and this community, and you can see that in everything that she has done through all her years here.
And lastly, we chose Jimmy Gentry, Coach Jimmy Gentry. Many of us think of him as a farmer, but he doesn't see himself as that. He was a longtime educator and coach here in Franklin, at Battleground Academy, Franklin High School, Brentwood Academy, and really has a passion, obviously, for this community, but from an education standpoint. Their farm obviously provides agro-tourism to this community, as he refers, but more than importantly, educational opportunities through the camps and through the opportunities just to have people come out there and experience the farm, which really in its entirety is represents the city of Franklin. So with that, we'd like for you to be able to hear from these living legacies themselves, and I'd like to turn your attention to the video.
Let's not let Franklin become any town USA. We are unique. Let's not let Franklin become any town USA. We are unique. We have, people are seeing that.
Black people have a lot of history. They put in a lot here.
I can remember when I was growing up, the stores on Main Street, they're still there today. Those two blocks on Main Street and in the square, we've got to keep them just like they are.
We believe our children and our youth deserve nothing less than the best that we can offer.
Well, I hope we could somehow carry on. Anyway, my time's about up, and I have a little nostalgia.
I feel very fortunate that I can sit here at this very moment and see the beauty of this terrain around us, and it's not covered with houses or apartments and subdivisions. I see that, and then if I turn to my left and look across the highway, I see a different story altogether. That's necessary, I understand, because people have to have somewhere to live, but I hope that we can keep it under control and not let it be covered with commercial houses and that sort of thing. I don't think there's enough money in the whole world for me to want to give this up. What I see around me right now. And I hope that it stays this way forever.
I really get upset sometimes because our children are just floundering around and they don't seem to have anybody who's really, you know, care for them enough. Now we've got these organizations that take in a few of the children. So I've tried my best to get the young people to know that they are part of this community and they need to contribute instead of hands out, gimme. That doesn't work like that. You've got to do that. So I think we need to train our young folk. It's all testing and all. No fun things at all in school now. So that's too bad.
I was born and raised out at Hillsboro. Today it's called Leaper's Fork, above our country store. My mother ran the store in the daytime. My father in the daytime ran a sawmill. My father had a third grade education. My mother had a sixth grade education. And they wanted me to be the first Lehu to ever go to college. And I hated every day of school. But even though they died at an early age, I was a teenager, I kept their wishes. I was a page in the United States Senate 1956. I got to know five presidents while I was up there, three of them on a personal daily basis before they became president, Kennedy, Johnson, and Nixon.
When I first began as General Sessions judge, I was also my own magistrate for writing warrants and then finding probable cause and then sentencing the folks. It was a sort of strange arrangement. But in these counties, you know, the first place, General Sessions judges didn't have to be attorneys. And so many of our counties in the state of Tennessee had non-lawyer judges. It became pretty much a sort of funny. From time to time, there'd be folks who were in the used car business or all kinds of different vocations, but they would also be the General Sessions judge.
Franklin is an old South town. It's moving away from it. But it's something that I appreciate, my generation appreciated. And I went to school here and went to Battleground. Walked from right over here up to Battleground and back. And it was a nice way to start your life.
I really get upset sometimes because our children are just floundering around and they don't seem to have anybody who's really, you know, care for them enough. Now we've got these organizations that take in a few of the children. So I've tried my best to get the young people to know that they are part of this community and they need to contribute instead of hands out, gimme. That doesn't work like that. You've got to do that. So I think we need to train our young folk. It's all testing and all. No fun things at all in school now. So that's too bad. Integration did not help the black person that much. Black children, they really did. And we are just now getting to the place where white teachers understand that black children won't eat them up. They were afraid of black children at first. And I would tell them all the time, a child is a child. Actually, Franklin had, and Weston County had less trouble with integration than any other small communities. When 2 years I spent out of Brentwood teaching, but when we came to Franklin Special School District and then when they integrated, and the system said, if you had a child K through 2, you went to this school. 3 and 4, you went to that school. 5, 6, 7, and 8, you went to that school. And if you didn't want your children to mix, then you put them some other place. And we didn't have any trouble with that at all. And I'm not aware of how much trouble they had in the county because I was so involved with the Franklin Special, you know. And then after I left the Johnson School, Mr. Brown called me one Sunday afternoon. I remember this, and this was right after integration. And he said, I'll see you Monday morning. And I said, why you gonna see me Monday morning? He was the principal of junior high. He said, because you're my teacher. I said, okay, whatever. And so we just went on, and I didn't have any problems. The only thing at the end of the first week, we had this supervisor who came around, and she said, we worried about you. And I said, excuse me, why are you worrying about me? Because you never taught white children. I said, Mrs. Sanders, a child is a child is a child to me. I teach children. I don't teach races. So she didn't say that anymore to me, you know. No, sir. But anyway, I've been, you know, I enjoyed the teaching. I really did. So I've been real proud of Franklin. And I went from Johnson School over to junior high. And then from junior high as assistant principal, then I went to middle school as principal and stayed there all those years. And I just would not let anybody define me about where I was living and my race. Because, and I'd go downtown sometimes, and if they didn't want to, you know, wait on me, I'd turn around and come out. My money was just as green as anybody else, you know. So I think that if we keep this feeling of friendship, of helping folk, and one thing we are now getting more and more concerned is about old folk, you know, which I'm glad of that. Not that I'm old, but, you know, we have some communities that just push old folk back. One time we were on a retreat, this is when I was principal, and we got the superintendent who said, I think we need to change Johnson School and it can become an office and you can store things. I said, over my dead body. So he said, well, I guess that settled that. I said, yeah, because if you do that, you'll have a riot of black people and I'm gonna lead it too. So he said, well, I guess that settles that, doesn't it? I said, it sure does. Because we just, I mean, that's the pride and joy. It's Alma Lowe, pride and joy of our community, Johnson School. His name is actually Charles C. Johnson School, you know, they shortened it to Johnson. And actually that school's named after a relative of mine, Dr. Johnson. And because he was really a person who cared for anybody. And it didn't make any difference. And I used to have it said with the children, I don't care whether you're red, white, black, or purple. And I'd say, when the wagon comes, you move. But doctor was like that. He didn't care who came in. If you were sick, then he'd take care of it. And he wasn't getting any money for it either. Because sometimes when they came to see him, they said, Doc, I don't have the money. He said, it's all right. But at Christmas, they'd bring something like chickens and opossum. Chickens all right, opossums and rabbits, they can have them. But that's how they paid him, you know. Mm-hmm. And he just took them. But we went in and I'm one of the last teachers that went in Johnson School. And when I went there, I was teaching the sixth grade class. And then from that, I moved on up teaching seventh and eighth grade. I'm a science major. So we did that. And Mr. Watkins was our principal. And he was really a nice man, really nice principal. And he soft-spoken. But if you did something wrong, that voice changed. And we had faculty meeting one time. Somebody had done something. I promise you, it wasn't me. And he was on him, and I'm sitting there. I didn't do that, boss. It wasn't me, boss, that did that. But he, you know, he really cared for the children, and that's what I liked about him. And he knew families, and he visited families, and he wasn't one of those principals that stayed in his office all the time either. He checked classrooms to see what everything was going on, if everything was right. Even to the point that he checked first thing in the morning to see if you had enough heat, if it was cool enough. And he came to my room one day and he stuck his head in and he said, I'm not going to ask you if it's warm enough in here for you. If it's 100 degrees in here, you'd still say you were cold. So I'm just leaving. It was so cute one day. One of the teachers came and she said, Miss Mills, I have to tell you something. I said, what? This darling little white boy walks up to me. And he said, these are the nicest slaves I've ever seen. And we've been talking about slavery all the time. He didn't know. You know, we said black people slaves. So he just thought we were slaves too. These are the nicest slaves. And so the teacher said, I hope you're not offended. I said, no, that's why we're here. We are teaching, you know. And I just thought it was so funny.
Thank you guys for your time. And also, I just want to mention, so the other part of our presentation was to make sure that these videos lived on various websites throughout the community, including Leadership Franklin's website, the Williamson Herald and Southern Exposure, Williamson, Inc., and Heritage Foundation so that the entire community could have access to them. So,
and also, just if I could add, we wanted this to be a project that would have life beyond this class. And so our hope is that next year a class would take on 5 more individuals and capture their stories as well. So thank you.
And Charles, you missed your shout out, but I did give you one.
Our group presentation. So we're going to introduce group number 3 now. The members include Linda Emlinger, Glenn Johnson, Wynn Limbright, Joanne Wilhite, and Kenneth Hill. Their project is a lake dock at Harlandale's Farm. This new permanent structure will be extended to accommodate additional visitors. And the project also includes a handicap accessible walkway. Let's hear more about this project from group number 3.
Good morning. My name is Glenn Johnson, and I'd like to take this time to introduce you to Group 3 Leadership Franklin 2016-2017. We feel fortunate to be a part of this class, and we will treasure the friendships forever. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Linda Emlinger. Dr. Kenneth Hill. Wynn Limbright. He stays in the bushes more than he does in the water, folks. And last but not least, Joanne Wilhite. We've had a great time during this class, and I really am honored to be a part of this group, and we'll treasure this forever. So at this time, I'd like to turn the presentation over to Joanne, who will provide you an overview of how this project evolved and how it came about. So, Joanne.
The project we are presenting today is based on a quality of life here in Franklin. The enhancements made to Franklin are on a regular basis. We are fortunate to have the opportunity to contribute to our community in which we live and work. The amenities throughout the city of Franklin have accommodated the young, old, the active, and passive. Today, we are presenting an amenity that will be accommodating to both of these. The park at Harlandale Farm has a body of water that is approximately 4.5 acres. This lake provides the enjoyment of fishing and relaxation. You'll see people fishing, sunbathing, reading, or just watching the waterfowl. We are here to introduce the new addition to this park. The fishing pier will accommodate both the young and old and is ADA accessible. No one will be left behind. There isn't a fishing pier in Williamson County that is ADA compliant. This was a huge milestone for this area. There isn't a better feeling when you're able to share your enjoyment with a loved one who has been limited in their quality of life. This is a personal triumph for me. Fishing was the quality time my mother and I spent together since I was a little girl. She always had a smile on her face when she was beside the water, catching fish, or just watching the bobber for hours. She is the inspiration behind this project. My mother had a stroke in 2000, which limited her in her abilities. We continued our love for fishing by modifying her transportation to the water. She would sit and ride her walker while being pushed over rough terrain. Let me tell you, that was a journey. We did whatever it took to have that time beside the water. She passed a couple of years ago, and I still enjoy our hobby for fishing. I hope everyone can make the memories we were able to make that will last forever.
Thank you, Joanne. We appreciate you providing some insight into the project and the inspiration behind this project. At this time, I would like to introduce Linda, who's going to give you an overview of some of the gateway to the lake and a description of what that's going to look like.
To help you all visualize the ongoing enhancements to the lake at Harlandsdale, we will be adding a tree-lined walkway that is descending from the parking pad to the fishing dock. Susan G. Coleman of Central Tennessee has agreed to partner with us for Breast Cancer Awareness Month, which is in October, to provide trees and benches. And the benches will be made from recycled jugs, so no maintenance. This will create a relaxing and aesthetically pleasing entryway to the dock while helping those with challenges make their way down to the lake. We anticipate this area continually developing to enhance its natural beauty.
Thank you, Linda. We are fortunate to, in this group, to have a individual, Mr. Wynn Limbright, who has penned a poem about our project. At this time, I'd like to ask Wynn to come up and recite the poem.
I would not hold your breath. This is not a Whitworth poem. This is from a fisherman, kind of. The dock at Harlandsdale Farm Park. The Franklin community is home to some very historic places, some wonderful schools, churches, and restaurants, not to mention some very famous country music faces. There is one special historic venue that has been on Franklin Road since 1933. It is, of course, the beautiful Harlandsdale Farm, that since 2007 is available to the public for free. The city of Franklin had a grand idea to preserve this historic Tennessee walking horse farm for years to come, a place for people to relax and fish a little, and to even view the resting place of the great midnight sun. The park at Harlandsdale Farm has been quite a hit, with a doggy park, green space to picnic, and walking trail. But if the lake could be equipped with an attractive and functional dock, it would for sure be a wonderful addition without fail. Can you imagine driving into the farm and parking close to the lake, pushing your sleeping child in a stroller on a smooth brick walkway so they'll not wake? Or can you imagine sitting on a comfortable park bench, located under the shade of an ornamental tree, reading Eric Jackson's book, For Cause, For Country? How serene and how relaxing that would be. Or dusting off your old fishing tackle box when your child or grandchild wants to fish, and now you have the most perfect nearby place to satisfy their every wish. Or maybe some visitor to these parts needs to just sit and relax for a spell, to clear the mind as the sun sets over the lake and be assured that in Franklin, all is well. We trust this dock project on Harlandsdale Farm Lake will serve this community long and well. And besides being a part of the Leadership Franklin 2017, had no comparable parallel. Welcome to the Harlandsdale Dock.
What you're seeing right now is an aerial that was created by some of the city colleagues. This is done by a drone, and we were able to get some aerial shots. If you watch, there is, it's a good sized lake, but there is somebody fishing on the lake at this time. He was seen in the earlier shot. But this will give you a general idea of what it is that we are going to be creating on the setting. The dock will be created by the end of this month. So hopefully you will be able to see by the 1st of May, when summer is here, children, grandparents, everyone just enjoying the aesthetics that will be in place. The benches will soon come, trees, but all will come with time. But this will be memories to come for everyone.
Thank you. A framed copy of the poem will be presented to the Parks Department for placement at Harlansdale Farm, and it can be seen over here to our right. So we're very gracious that they have chose to place this at the farm so that all can enjoy Wynn's work. As we conclude, I would like to ask Dr. Hill to come before us to bless this project with a prayer. At the conclusion of this prayer, our presentation will be over. Thank you, Dr.
Hill. As we bow our heads, going to lay down my burdens down by the lake. Going to talk to God down by the lake. Going to think about God down by the lake. Going to walk with God down by the lake. Going to sing to God down by the lake. Going to listen to God down by the lake. Going to pray to God down by the lake. Going to catch God's spirit down by the lake. Going to see God's beauty down by the lake. Going to feel God's presence down by the lake. Going to praise God's name down by the lake. Going to rest in peace down by the lake. Going to lead me to still water down by the lake. Going to remember new relationships created down by the lake. Going to remember new friendships formed down by the lake. Going to remember the gift of leadership, Franklin, down by the lake. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Okay, group four will be making their way up. I'm good. How are you doing? Hey, how you doing? Good to see you. Okay, I think we're ready to get started with our last group, group number four. Their members include Laura Chavarria, Kim Hamner, Ernie Reynolds, Patty Bearden, and Drew Freeman. And so now we're ready to get RAD, as earlier I was mistaken. So this stands for Get Real Against Drugs. Group two coordinated with the Williamson County Sheriff Office's Drug Task Force and the Franklin YMCA to host two Get Rad informational meetings in February. These sessions included exhibits, videos, and very specific information on illicit drug use in Franklin and Williamson County. Let's hear more about Get Rad from group number four.
Thank you. The seed for our project initiative, Get Rad, was sown on Leadership Franklin Law Enforcement Day. In the setting of the jail, investigator Brad Fan and his Williamson County Sheriff's team described the devious and sophisticated means by which drugs are produced for, marketed to, and abused by our children. From the frightening subtlety of earwax to the bold arrogance of Skittle parties, we were moved that so many trappings exist here in our community. The information shared with us was powerful, and we wished for means to put it in front of a greater targeted audience. And so, Get Rad was born.
Our group of five met with all of these questions head on. How do we help to fight this, to fight against drugs in Williamson County? How do we share the information that Investigator Fan has presented to us with our community? We want to reach out to the parents and the grandparents, teachers, educators, anyone who is involved with these young people in our community. How do we promote this program? That was another question that we were facing. What resources could help us get the word out about drug abuse in Williamson County? We came up with a plan of action. We decided that we would move forward with some aggressive marketing. WAKM 950 Radio interviewed investigator Brad Fan and replayed the segments in interims in commercials. A visible banner, which is behind us, was placed outside the Franklin YMCA, a strategic point we felt like because there was a lot of traffic and a lot of people coming and going to the Y. Through our use of social media, we used Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Email was also used with the Franklin Leadership alum, the Boys and Girls Club Education Foundation of Williamson County, of the Williamson County Board. Flyers were printed, and Kim and her husband distributed those for us throughout the city of Franklin. The Williamson Herald, Cassie and Derby, we want to thank you, ran some ads for us that gave all of our strategic information.
Our first task was to come up with a name. Our program, we felt, was in the same vein as DARE, Drug Abuse Resistance Education. So we wanted to come up with something that engaged parents to get involved, but was also catchy and hip. So Get Rad was born, Get Real About Drugs. So our first session was on Thursday, February 9th, held at the Franklin Family YMCA. We had approximately 35 people in attendance. Guests included Debbie Henry, Sheriff Long, program chairs Connie and Brenda, Tom Lawrence, and classmate Cassie. You may be wondering why we have smiley faces throughout the presentation. It's to cover the identity of those from the Sheriff's Department that are undercover. We did have some visual aids that touch on the drugs that are in our county. There's Drew kicking off the program and welcoming folks for coming to the Franklin Family YMCA. And of course, Ernie schmoozing, which is what he does best. Debbie Henry, thank you for attending. And our group minus Patty.
We determined that balancing the population of our community against the resources of storytellers that were in place, it was appropriate to go with quarterly sessions with dates and times alternating between weekday evenings and weekend mornings so as to make the program accessible to working parents. Additionally, we wanted the venues to vary so as to reach the most diverse geographical audience that we could. Our goal is to create a better awareness for parents, other family members, educators, and any and all interested community members of the types of drugs available to our children, their means of production and distribution, and the alarming quantities that are consumed.
At this time, we are very honored to have investigator Brad Phan in our presence today. Many of you, all of you almost, have heard and seen Brad with his presentation. And Brad, we cannot thank you enough. Brad has elaborate displays and PowerPoint presentations. And Brad, you just kind of knocked the socks off of all of us that day. But we're
so
glad to have you. At this time, Brad, we'll turn it over to you.
I'll first say that I'm long-winded, so if I exceed my time, Ms. Lahr, just grab me by the collar and jerk me off, and I'll move and get out of the way. Couple of questions that were asked of us. I see you all have a Skittle party going on right here.
We do.
How was each session different? The first session, I felt like people paid more attention. They were really intrigued in the information that we were putting out to them. We urge these classes and these presentations that we put on to be a feedback. We want people to talk to us and ask us questions throughout the session, and we got that. And we were able, it's a long presentation. This presentation actually started as us teaching it through our in-service, which is about a four-hour in-service to our law enforcement. And we tried to cram it down as much as we could and still get as much information out as we could into an hour and a half, 2 hours, whatever that time frame was. The second session, the people that did come, a couple of them had already been and seen our first presentation, so they had lots of questions. And we got more away from the presentation. We actually didn't get to finish the presentation because there were so many questions. And some of those questions were, what do we do? How do we reach parents and make our parents aware of what these kids are seeing? And we were fortunate enough, there was a guy that Investigator Lusk was able to get with. I think they're working on creating some kind of app for school-aged children to be able to get on that app and send in anonymous tips of some, you know, say you've got a kid in school selling marijuana. There were some really good ideas that came from that session. The unfortunate part of it was we didn't get to finish our session. And we offered the opportunity to come back and give that session, teach that whole class again. So the feedback portion of it was very good. One of the things that I found, and it's frustrating to us as law enforcement, is how many people live in Williamson County? Just a wild guess. Thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. 55 people showed up to these classes. 55 parents showed up to these classes. That concerns us as law enforcement. And we as a group have talked about it, and we call it the bubble. We're in Franklin. We're in Williamson County. We are in the wealthiest county in the state of Tennessee. And everybody thinks it's somewhere else. It's not here. And one of the things that we teach in that class, in our presentation, is nobody in this room, nobody in Williamson County, is immune from these things wherever our posters are. Nobody's immune from these things. No one is immune from our problems with the pills. And the problem that we see as law enforcement, especially with the school-age children, is parents aren't involved with children. It would surprise everybody in here how many homes we go into, and, you know, it's a parent that's called about a child. You know, I can't do anything with him. He's got his door closed. He won't let us in, blah, blah, blah. And you go in the room, it's a complete disaster. And you ask mom and dad, you know, when's the last time you got in here? I never go in his room. I never go in his room. We live in a bubble. And then when all of a sudden, I'll use for an example, Brentwood High School. We did a roundup a couple of months ago where we made 37 felony arrests on an operation that we did. Out of that operation, 37 arrests, all adults, the following week we went to Brentwood High School and made one arrest and got more U.S. currency and more drugs out of a 17-year-old child's room right in Brentwood. He had a safe that was crammed full of money, and we netted more money and more drugs from that one house than we did out of an operation where we did 37 undercover buys. A 17-year-old. In our talks with mom and dad, hey, did you know? Did you had a problem? Yeah, we knew he had messed with weed for a while, and we tried to take his truck away and so on and so forth. Ultimately, we seized his truck, took all that cash that we found in the safe, took all the drugs. And the problem that we see is the parents don't start addressing the problem until we as law enforcement show up and arrest that kid, take that car. Being a parent and wanting to take care of that child, you're doing the parent thing because you don't want that felony on his record. You don't want it to ruin his college career. You don't want it to ruin his career in the future. That's the wrong time to get involved in the child's life. And it will knock you over how many parents are not involved. And that's why we in law enforcement call it the bubble. And we can't stress enough to people in this room, nobody in here, nobody in this room is immune to the problems in our county. And in our sessions, we try to show photos, we have displays, we've gone out of our way to make things like mock meth labs, mock crystal methamphetamine, trying to make parents see that maybe you've been in your child's room and you've seen a folded up piece of aluminum foil, or the best example I can give is a $1 bill. How do you carry money in your pocket? A wallet? I carry mine in the money clip folded one time. Bet you there's somebody in this room that you've seen your child or your grandchild empty their pocket, see it on the nightstand or something, a dollar bill folded up just as tiny as it can be, that big. Why do you do that? You do that because there's something in that dollar bill. There's something in that dollar bill. They're saving that dollar bill for a reason. So part of what we try to teach is, that's your kid. Pick that dollar bill up and see what's in that dollar bill. You don't fold dollar bills and keep them in your pocket for a reason. You spend money, and you have to have easy access to it to get it out and spend it in a store. So that's part of our presentation, is to try to get that out there and make parents aware that there's things in your home that you see that you probably have no clue what you're looking at. Do I think the program met its goal? I do think it met its goal for the people that attended. Is there a need for this community to have this program continue? Not a doubt in my mind. Not a doubt in my mind. Here's the question. How do we do it? And who's going to do it? Who's going to step up? We as law enforcement, we're in. We've created the PowerPoint. Every time these people have called, we've came. on the social media, we've had numerous people hit us up on social media and ask us, when could you do this presentation in our subdivision, Tollgate subdivision? And we respond back, tell us when. Name a time. We don't get the responses back. So again, we're in the bubble. Who's going to step up and continue what they've started? Because there is an imperative need for it. And to tell you one quick thing, to show you that no one in this room is immune from this problem. My partner, one of my best partners that I've got, lost one of his children to a drug addiction. Lost one of his own children to a drug addiction. He couldn't handle it anymore. Blew his knee out trying to play football. Excellent, excellent football player. Scholarships. He had it all. Experimented with the drugs. Got in so deep, he couldn't take it anymore. So he wound up committing suicide. So that is proof that nobody in this room is immune from what's going on in our community today. That's my time.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
So as Investigator Fan mentioned, the real question is what happens next, right? I mean, this is a project for this year, but obviously the issues aren't going to go away because we've had a couple of sessions. So I just wanted to mention a couple of ways that we as a Y are going to get involved and ways that you guys can also get involved. One special thing that happened, we had a family that attended the second session that got so enthralled and so passionate about what they heard is that they felt like, hey, we need more of our friends and more of our community to hear about this, because it's not just what happens in your home, right? It's also what happens in the homes of your friends. So they offered to cater an event. We were thinking about a back-to-school type of event, maybe a barbecue, to where we can invite people. We know food will give people to you. And hopefully we can invite them with food, and then hopefully they'll learn something along the way. Because we absolutely have heard, no matter how many times we hear his presentation, we learn something every time. So that's one way we're going to move this forward. Another way is that obviously through our social media pages and ask other business partners to do it through their social media pages, maybe to work with the Herald, work with WAKM to do some radio spots. We are dedicated as a Y to be committed to make sure that this is out there and people are aware of this, and working with Amy and her friends with the sheriff's office. They're invited to a health fair that we're going to have in 2 weeks, so they'll set up their table there. So everything that we have at the Y that may be remotely related to this issue, we're going to invite them and let them tell us no or yes in that way. So we're committed to that. We're going to continue our sessions at the Y and then at the Franklin Housing Community Center, and then hope to do them more and more places, maybe the Boys and Girls Club. We'd love to get connected with them, even with CASA families, with some foster parents and some adoptive parents, groups like that where we can, you know, help them understand maybe even where they're going and things that they need to know. So they're aware of that dollar bill that may be folded oddly, or that 2-liter drink that may have a hole at the bottom. You know, it's amazing what these kids can learn off of YouTube today to learn these things. So Patty has invited them to do a segment at the Rotary. So again, that's a completely different group of people that's going to hear, business leaders, and really some of our senior citizens in this area, to learn about what to do with their own prescription medications, right? A lot of these kids are being exposed to medications from their grandparents who just aren't aware that these are bad when they're abused in that way. And of course, we hope that in the end that some Leadership Franklin class in the future will continue what we've started. We'd welcome them to work with us as a Y to do, you know, just to tag along with what we're doing. But we definitely agree with Investigator Fan that we're just the beginning step in this, that it's going to take everybody in this room to really tackle this problem in the right way. And our biggest influence is going to be that when you hear or when you see something from the Y or even from anybody up here, share it on your social media. We know that can get a viral response and reach more people than we could ever reach during any of these sessions. So those are just a few ways that we plan on getting this perpetuated throughout.
And we want to end with extending our thanks to so many people who are involved. You've heard their names, some of them, throughout this presentation, but I would like to take this opportunity to recap those. Of course, we could not have done this without Investigator Fan. We're very grateful to the Williamson County Sheriff's Office, the Narcotics Investigation Division, Brad Fan, We've also got Amy Cole, Justin Long, Paul Lusk, and John Pierce. And without their dedication and passion for purging our community of drugs, we wouldn't have been able to get this out into the community. So we are very grateful to y'all. We also want to thank Cassie and Derby and Austin Thompson of the Williamson Herald for their help. There was an article that was written and ads and at a reduced rate, the Leadership Franklin rate. Family and friends, right? So we are very, very grateful. And we used their ad as flyers, so we were able to kind of duplicate that. Also, Brandy Blanton, Southern Magazine, Exposure Magazine, very thankful to you and your support. And Tom Lawrence of WAKM Radio had several, Patty, and I think everybody on this panel except for me, were on the program, along with Investigator Fan as well. So, and numerous ads, again, at a reduced rate, family and friends. So we are very, very grateful. Mike Alexander with Signs First provided the banner at a reduced rate that behind us. And also Drew, of course, good contact there at the Franklin Family YMCA. Very grateful to them for hosting us at the first session and allowing us to promote it there. And also his connections to the Franklin Housing Authority, where YCAP is located. They also distributed flyers there in that community. Very helpful to us. And of course, many thanks to Sheriff Jeff Long for his support and attending the first session. And Debbie Henry was at our first session. Connie and Mark Bond. Connie attended both sessions. How great is that? So, yay. And J. Edward Campbell, Brenda's husband, was able to join us. That was great for the first session. And then Patty's husband, John, and then my husband, Kelly, also attended as well. And Kelly helped me distribute the flyers, too. So, but we are very grateful to all. And again, couldn't have done this without Investigator Fan and his team. So very grateful to all. And hope that you will continue to promote this whenever you get the opportunity to make that connection to and reach out to Brad Fan and his group. So thank you all.
Awesome.
The picture.
Skittle party is where we all have pain medications. You go to the doctor, you got a legitimate knee injury, back injury, whatever it is, and that doctor prescribes you a pain prescription, oxycodone, roxycodone, Lopinus, whatever the pain medication is. You go home, you use it for a short time frame, knee gets better, back gets better. He's giving you a script for 60 pills. You've used four of them. What do you do with that script? You go put it in the medicine cabinet. Man, I might have trouble out of my knee later on, and I've got it. I don't have to hurt. But what we have found with our teenagers, middle schoolers, high schoolers, they also know you have that script. So they're going to go out, they're going to go to a party called a skittle party. So what they do is they know you've got about 55 or 54 pills left in your bottle. They're getting ready to go out on their party. They go into the cabinet, get five or six of your pills out of it because you're never going to miss them. Get to the party, and when you get to the party, part of your cover charge, just like you were going to a bar, part of your cover charge is when you come in and get to the door, you deposit in the bowl whatever pill you brought. The bowl may be full because there's 15, 20 other people there. You don't know what's in that bowl. Oxycodone, Lopinus, diazepine, alprazolam. You don't know what's in that bowl. But part of the cover charge is, and where the fun starts, is you deposit what's in your pocket. But before before you can get in, you have to take something else out of the bowl. Pocket. Then you start drinking the alcohol, the beer, wine, whiskey, whatever it is. And that's how the night goes on. Back and forth to the bowl, back and forth to the bowl. And those kids have not one clue what they're taking in that. It could be something as simple as an alprazolam, which is a nerve medication that you simply kind of mellow you out a little bit. Or it could be an opanum, an extremely, extremely potent pain medication that could, I mean, virtually for somebody that doesn't take them, I mean, it could put you comatose. They don't know what they're taking, and they're mixing it with alcohol. Our overdose rate this year, from January 1 to right now, we're on track to exceed last year's overdose rate enormously. I think it was last week, 2 weeks ago, we had 3 overdoses in this county in one day. I just got a text message yesterday from my lieutenant in my division that she had gotten word that we also had 3 overdoses yesterday in our county. Some of those are unintentional because of the heroin and our fentanyl problem. Some of them were unintentional. But I can tell you right now, we are on track. We will exceed last year's overdose rate and probably by an enormous rate. We've almost already hit last year's overdose rate. And this is what, April? We've almost already hit last year's overdose rate. So, anybody here that thinks we're in a bubble and it's not here, I'm here to tell you it's here. One of the questions that I ask, does anybody in the room think that heroin is making a comeback? Show of hands, how many people think heroin is making a comeback? Everybody in here is wrong. Because I'm telling you, and I have 3 other investigators back there that can confirm it, it's not making a comeback. It is here. It is here. We made a traffic stop 2 weeks ago out on the interstate. Not heroin. 10 kilos. A kilo is 2.2 pounds. 10 kilos of crystal methamphetamine come from Texas to here, right here in Franklin, Tennessee. 22 pounds of crystal methamphetamine came right here to Franklin. So anybody that thinks we're not affected by the Mexican drug cartels, you're mistaken. We are. And if you don't think we have problems, we do. And it's our job, it's y'all's job to help us educate those parents and those kids as to what they're facing and what they're dealing with. Because that one dose of heroin that's laced with fentanyl may very well be their last. Thank you.
While they're doing that, I'll go ahead and kind of say my closing remarks. But again, I want to thank the alumni of Leadership Franklin that are here today. I want to thank the media that are here today. And I'd like to thank you for allowing me to be your MC again this year. It is an honor to be able to do this. I think this is my 4th year that I've done this, and apparently it is from now on, from what I'm being told. But it is great to see the presentations that are made from each class each year, and every year it just seems to get better and better and better. But again, I'd like to congratulate all the groups, and the great projects that have been presented here today. So you should feel very proud, obviously, for what you've accomplished. And I'm sure it doesn't seem that 8-9 months ago when you started out and you were spending 12-hour days, one day a week, that it would go by this fast, but it has, and you're here today to celebrate that. I'm sure you can all look back and appreciate what you've seen, what you've learned, and what you've experienced. As of today, you're going to join an elite group of Leadership Franklin alumni, and you should be very proud of that. You've referred to yourself as the best class ever of Leadership Franklin, and to continue to make that claim to that title, I encourage you all to stay involved with the Leadership Franklin through the alumni program. You're going to hear more about the alumni program later today, I think, hopefully. So I encourage you all to attend and support the alumni events in the future, including graduation day. Debbie and Paula continue to do a great job for Leadership Franklin, and I know they'll appreciate your continued support and involvement with Leadership Franklin. With that, this concludes the project presentations, and thank you.